also say, it may seem like there are a number of delivery vehicles around, but if it also reduces the number of trips to a brick and mortar store, then, you know, they can achieve economies through, you know, pool resources, you know, multiple deliveries on a route, that sort of thing.
Yeah, that's an excellent point, because we're quick to think, oh, now there's more trucks in my neighborhood, but in fact, before, everybody was individually going to the store and bringing that stuff back to their house. So it would be less trips if it weren't for the fact that people do seem to need to get out of the house. So there's still, people are still making about the same number of trips. So there seems to be a net increase, but in terms of efficiency, you may be right that there could be some balancing out. And in fact, if you look at both of these trends in relative to the supply chain, at a pretty high level, you know, what our economic experts are telling us is that, you know, kind of the economic driver of information technology, transport and warehousing that's behind micro production can actually, So micro production and home delivery are both down here. But technology in the sense of better information, so you know how Uber and Lyft are really efficient in how they match people with drivers and plan trips. That's happening on the wholesale side as well. And in fact, those companies themselves are a little bit involved in that as well. So as we have better information about the movement of goods, there's an opportunity for that to become more efficient. And then that means higher capacity, lower costs, and that can drive down the total amount of travel. So that's a positive aspect of technology. But the retail home deliveries and the localized production actually can have an impact of decreased efficiency. And part of that is really just the expectations that they set up. Because Amazon offers to deliver how quickly in this region?
It's 3 or 4
hours.
Days.
Okay, 3 or 4 days. Okay. We have 2 hours in Richmond for some things.
Yeah.
Right. Because we have a fulfillment center right there. So when you get into those expectations of I want it now, that in particular will drive up the amount of travel and drive down efficiency. So what you have here is technology and these other disruptive trends kind of driving the outcome in two opposite directions. So it could get better or it could get worse, right? So that's a good reason to do exploratory planning, because when you do exploratory planning, you can take a look at these trends and to say, well, let's play out a future where this trend is more dominant and see what happens, and then let's play out another future where this trend is more dominant and see what happens there. And that's a reason for doing exploratory planning, so you can start to ask those questions and see how it turns out. So let me ask you about this region. Which of the economic disruptors would you say are affecting Treasure Valley the most? And I want you to pick two this time. So e-commerce and home delivery, the supply side of e-commerce, which is, you know, maybe more at the micro-production. Micro-production is the second one. So the supply side of e-commerce is if you have a fulfillment center, like a major employer or that sort of a thing. Farm-to-table is another version of this trend as well, trying to produce things closer to where they're consumed, and other types of local sourcing, or maybe you have another idea. So pick two. Is everybody done? 3, 2, 1. And let's see what we got. All right, so e-commerce home delivery is the big one. And then farm to table. So tell me about farm to table. How is that playing out in this region? Is it affecting the scale of farming?
We have a lot of smaller neighborhood plots where people are growing vegetables, community gardening.
Good. And you may not know. I was actually reading up on some trends and seeing that, you know, the ag industry is going through some changes in this region, is it not?
We're losing some ag land to development homes.
Right. So, yeah, because you're kind of, you're not super constrained yet, right? But there is only so much land.
Right.
Yeah. So, interesting. Okay, so now let's talk about technology disruptors. I'm going to focus on four main areas: connected vehicles, autonomous vehicles, which are somewhat related, mobility as a service, we'll circle back to that, and then also information systems. All of these aspects of technology are going to have a big impact on transportation. So has everybody heard at least a little bit about connected and autonomous vehicles? That's for the most part. Just, okay, most of you, but maybe not everybody. So connected vehicles are vehicles that are communicating with each other or the infrastructure. And then autonomous vehicles are vehicles that are doing everything themselves. So, and I'll go into the details of that a little bit more. But, this is something that is really taking off. 55 international cities are hosting connected or automated vehicles. Now 29 international are gearing up for it. So it's happening quickly. And these numbers are changing quickly. They're actually a month old and they're probably a little bit out of date. But most of them are either doing it through mobility as a service in cars like Uber and Lyft. And I understand there was a Uber pedestrian fatality.
Yeah.
Day.
So they shut that down. Uber stopped their autonomous research for right now, just until they figure out kind of what happened.
Okay, in Tempe or everywhere?
Everywhere. They've shut it down for right now while they're trying to figure out kind of what went wrong there.
Okay. So, and imagine if we did that for human drivers. But the point being that of course we have headlines. That's not surprising, but it's interesting that we have a different safety.
If anyone talked about how when someone gets hit by a car, how they're talking about this situation, we would be a lot further than where we are right now.
Yeah, that's a great point. Autonomous transit vehicles is another way that people are doing pilot tests right now. So these are they're like an elevator on wheels, basically. They can only go 25 miles an hour. They can only handle a 7% grade. But it's not unlike an elevator. And one reason I mentioned that is because a good analogy for autonomous vehicles is the elevator. When they first invented the elevator in the 1800s, people were astonished, that you could go up and down tall buildings, and it changed the urban landscape dramatically. But you had an elevator operator in there till like the 1940s. And people were terrified of the elevators operating themselves. And we had the technology for elevators to operate without a human for a long time before people were willing to get into elevators without operators. And it actually took a massive strike in New York City that pretty much shut the city down for people to realize that maybe that was something they could put in the past and move beyond. The interaction of technology and human nature and our sense of safety is all kind of the psychology accepting new technology, and that's an important part of how we're moving in this direction. So this seems to be workable. It's small. It holds up to like 11 people, and it's autonomous, but it's going on a set route. Okay, so we have a few dozen of those. Those are also popping up, new ones every day. Then we have mobility as a service, and we've talked about this. So Uber and Lyft and people trusting their phone to give them information that allows them to feel safe getting into a car with a stranger. And then information systems are also an important part of technology. Better information allows us to travel more efficiently. Do we all use Google and Waze on our phones, right? The supply of the goods movement is making good use of that information as well. So as we think about how to get more use out of the transportation system we already have, information is very powerful because it can help people change the time of their trip or change the route of their trip and get, the whole system working more effectively rather than people just always going the same way they normally go every day. So information systems are very important. And in the future, a couple things to keep in mind. One is, let me ask you this. So one of the first pilots of autonomous vehicles was done by Google. Why do you think Google wants to provide autonomous transportation. What do they make their money on?
Information.
Advertising, right? They track information about people and then they sell that so that others can buy advertising. So our movements in Uber and Lyft and other vehicles are of great value to some other people who want to sell us things or understand our movements. It's a boon for transportation planners, honestly, to be able to know where people are going on all their trips. Our use of big data is really improving how we plan. So data is like, one of the expressions is data is the new oil. It's basically something that is emerging that's very valuable. And therefore, so cities like Austin that kind of held off on letting Uber and Lyft operate in their cities, they then negotiated having access to the data, because normally Uber and Lyft don't share their data. And so then Austin is making good use of that. And a couple cities even have it, you know, in an open source platform. So so being strategic about the data that's being generated by the information systems is very important, so that we're not just giving away the farm, if you will, but also as we think about things like our traditional transportation funding mechanisms perhaps being negatively impacted by some of these same trends, we have to find new sources of revenue, and information could be very important in that regard as well. So information systems are, you know, have many facets to them, if you will, something for us to think about in the future. So one of the big questions is when is this gonna happen? And nobody agrees on that answer at all. Even like our expert in my company, who was the Michigan DOT ITS manager before he came to our company, has a pretty strong opinion about this, and he and I don't agree. So there's a lot of opinions about this. But this is called the hype cycle. And this applies to all technology. They've done a lot of research. And what happens is innovation, you start with innovation, and it builds and it builds. And then you get to what's called the peak of inflated expectations. Oh my gosh, it's here. It's happening. It's real. Such as when Uber started their driverless pilot in Pittsburgh. That was a big deal. And so in about 2016, autonomous vehicles sort of reached that peak of expectations. So the people who put this out every year in 2017, they put autonomous vehicles just past the peak, but this yellow triangle means that it will take more than 10 years for it to come to fruition, to move through the rest of the cycle. So the next phase is called the trough of disillusionment. So now you have it out there, and what happened today is a perfect example of that. So, things go wrong. The turtle goes back in the shell for a minute, try to figure out what's going on. And people will start to forget about it or think, oh, that, you know, what happened to all that hype? But it's being improved and refined, and it will make its way out into the marketplace as something that's viable and will transform our economy and other things. So we best not forget about it while it's going through the trough of disillusionment. But there's a lot of argument about sort of where we are today and when we're going to get to fully autonomous vehicles. So there's a scale of 0 to 5. So there's 6 levels of vehicle autonomy. 0 is no automation. So, you know, probably like most of our cars, if your car is more than a couple years old. Then you get to driver assistance, which we've had for a while, and that's things like, helping you parallel park or, warning that you need to brake, that sort of thing. Partial automation is something like adaptive cruise control, where the car is really doing something smart to help you drive better, but you still have to have your hands on the wheel the whole time. 3 is conditional automation, where you could let the car do most things and just intervene when you need to. And I think the industry is realizing we should probably skip that one. And that's feasible, because where a lot of manufacturers are right now is 4, but they will also tell you there are some things they need to figure out to get all the way to 5. The big car manufacturers, the OEMs as we call them, are not quite there. But they're foreseeing that they will be soon after 2020 for the most part. But the Googles came into this space at level four, and they are on a turnaround cycle. The tech industry is on a turnaround cycle that's much faster than the auto industry. So it's hard to say exactly how quickly we'll get here, but most people are thinking that we'll have fully autonomous vehicles available in the early 2020s. And then how quickly they become universal is a function of a lot of different factors. And that's, again, something that you could look at in an exploratory scenario process and say, well, what are things we like if we're at this level in 2050 versus some other level of automation? Because we can all sit here and think of an answer to this, but we don't necessarily know what's going to happen.
I don't know if this will make sense, but so when humans are driving vehicles, and like picture the freeway out here, my understanding is that oftentimes traffic is caused by someone kind of panics and brakes a little bit, and that sends a wave back, and that's really, in my opinion, a human caused traffic jam. Say we got to full autonomy tomorrow, and everyone was driving a car that was connected and autonomous, and no one's braking. Do you have an idea, given the infrastructure in place today, like how much more traffic we could handle, or
Smart people are studying that very question, and so I actually was on a panel 2 weeks ago at a conference called Urbanism Next, which is talking about how cities are dealing with this. And so one of the guys who's been actively working on playing that out with travel demand models made a very interesting point, and that is that what will happen will vary by the facility type, and that was when we did our exploratory planning in Virginia. That was a critical insight. So different parts of the transportation network will handle that change differently, but on the highway, it's 80 to 100% more throughput. So, a couple things: can our bridges handle that? Their load ratings are not designed for that. Number two, what they found in the modeling exercise is you went from most congestion being caused by people merging onto the highway to most congestion being caused by people merging off of the highway, because you can't get 100% increase out of the transportation system at the next level down, let's say the arterial. And what we found in Virginia is it really starts to break down when you get to two-lane roads, because there's just not much more you can do with the two-lane road than have somebody going in each direction. So it's an interesting question, and that's a very good example of something that you can sort of get into the weeds with in an exploratory planning process and play that out through your travel demand models or just make some higher level assumptions. But either way, you can start to see what some of the risks and the opportunities might be around that very issue. So that's a great insight. So again, we don't know when, but it's probably not much sooner than 2040. And not much later than 2050. And what happens between now and then is interesting, because we're going to have a mixed fleet, right? That's a whole other thing in itself to think about. So connected vehicles are talking to each other, but detecting pedestrians, because, you know, whether it's the vehicle being smart or because pedestrians have a Fitbit or something that puts out a signal, or the transportation system detects them and tells the car. Vehicle to network, so the traffic signal is telling you what's happening ahead. Vehicle to infrastructure, oops, sorry, I got that wrong. Vehicle to infrastructure, what's happening again. Vehicle to network is, you know, way down the road, there's a traffic jam, maybe you want to go around it. So the connected part is a lot of information, and having the cars be smarter. I mean, think about it. Today, you can sort of tell what someone is doing next to you on the road or in front of you on the road, but you certainly can't know what they're going to do. If somebody's programmed their trip into their car and that car is sharing that information with the other cars, then the cars not only know, you know, what's happening now, but also what's going to happen. So the opportunity to get more efficiency out of the system is tremendous. Now, automated vehicles they're detecting on their own. They've got a lot of sensors, and they're figuring out how to navigate the urban environment. They can detect objects in rain, fog, or snow, but they have some things they have to figure out. For example, I'm a fan of the show Seinfeld. I don't know if any of you have seen that, but there's an episode where George, one of the characters, is driving his car in the city and he runs over a pigeon and he's very upset about it because he says, we have a deal with the pigeons. We drive towards them and they fly away, and this one didn't keep its end of the bargain. Well, think about how to program a car to know that some things that are in the road are stationary and you have to stop for them, and some things won't leave unless you drive towards them. So it's a complicated setting for vehicles to figure out. There's a few things we humans can do that it'll be challenging to get cars to do as well or better, but that's what they're working on. Ultimately, vehicles will be connected and automated. That's the best possible scenario. And so this is a little animation. So the vehicle's approaching the intersection too fast. The system knows that the light is going to turn red. So the approaching vehicle then receives a message from the traffic signal that says, hey, you're going too fast. The light is going to change. And the driver gets an alert, and that allows him to stop in time, although he's still in the crosswalk. That's where we are now. But note that in that example, the signal told the car and the car told the driver. We're actually capable of the signal telling the car and the car slowing down, but that's a great leap forward, and we haven't allowed that to happen yet in our smart vehicle.
That a question, my mind goes to the signal tells the car tells the driver, and so the driver floors it to get through the intersection in time. I can see that being almost more
like
dangerous.
Yeah, and more dangerous, yeah. No, that's a good point, and that's...
Then you have automated tickets.
Right. 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 Yes, like you need automated, that's where you have the camera and hold it. Yeah, so there's a lot of variables that have to work themselves out, and how the insurance industry and how the states create a legal framework for that. These are things that are going to have to happen over the next decade to sort of channel the good parts of the technology in the direction we want it to go and disincentivize the negative things that could happen. One of the things I've heard people say is, you know, this dream of getting all these more cars through on the highway is a long ways off, because as long as there are human drivers who know that those automated vehicles will let them in front of them and not hit them, you know, they're liable to just cut them off. So there's good and bad to humans. We understand birds, but we're liable to do some risky things. So as transportation planners, what we really need to be thinking about is how are these things going to affect our driving behavior, and in turn, the demands that we put on the transportation system. So we've looked closely at this issue, and the way to tackle this is to sort of break it down. So here are some of the things that we're talking about. Number one is what we call induced mobility. So as soon as the cars can drive themselves, people who can't drive have a level of mobility that they don't have today. So if you're 12-year-old needs to go to soccer practice and you're doing something else, you just let the car take them. Or if you're elderly, disabled, you know, you have reasons that you can't drive because of vision or mobility, then the car is going to take you to do whatever it is you want to do. So that's going to sort of unleash latent demand that, you know, people have already for trips that they're not able to make. Then you've got, some people are calling this zombie trips. We dubbed it ZOV, zero occupant vehicles, and that's when you send the car to get your pharmacy, your prescription from the pharmacy for you with nobody in it. Or when you have driverless Uber, you drop somebody off and then you have to travel to pick up the next passenger, which is an empty car driving on the road. So in theory, that, you know, depending on how efficient that is, but in general, we would expect that to drive up the demand for travel. And the convenience factor of short trips, the fact that, oh, I'm cooking, I forgot, you know, a special ingredient, and I can send the, you know, I go on the computer, I tell the grocery store what I want, the car goes and gets it for me. I would have worked my recipe around that if I had to go get it, because I'm already cooking, but the convenience factor is going to induce more trips. Now, we talked about the fact that parking might go down, so that's something that would reduce demand, particularly in urban areas. not only the fact that they don't park, but they don't circulate to find parking. So in some cities, that's a big part of BMT. Another thing that people who kind of gravitate to the dystopian view of the technology future are very worried about is once you can do something else in your car entirely, such as hold a conference call or get work done or watch a movie even, people will be willing to have much longer commutes. So a lot of that boils down to cost and economics. Is there change in their housing value worth that extra investment of time? In some regions, that would be a big deal. In some others, it probably wouldn't make sense. But overall, a lot of these trends are driving us towards more travel demand. So it sounds like probably get more out of our transportation system, but there's also going to be more demand. So I'll circle back to that later. So those are the technology disruptors. So I want you to rank what will change the most as travel becomes safer. So you have to click in the order from most important to least important. Congestion will come down. People will make more car trips as a result of travel being safer. There will be more walking and biking because it's safer. The cost of travel will go down, or maybe you could think of something else. So I'll give you some time. So I want you to put those in order from most important to least important in terms of how much of an impact will safety, the fact that driving becomes safer, how will it impact transportation. So in Virginia, we have this crazy thing called slugging. Has anybody ever heard of that? So we have an HOV3 corridor on the I-95 corridor, and people for years and years, before we had apps, would gather at the park and rides in the morning and line up, and just with, you know, verbal cues, you know, Pentagon West, you know, people would call out where they're going, and people get in the car. And there's something special about HOV3. Three people in the car feel safer than two people in the car who don't. But so this was like, you know, the dinosaur version of Uber and Lyft in a lot of ways, because this let the car, the driver, then go use the HOV lane. So they were getting to work faster. These other people are getting a free ride. And don't ask me how it worked in reverse on how people would get home. but it's been going on in the greater DC region for a long time. And now apps are making it even more efficient, if you will. But so there is a possibility that people will use it to team up and take rides together. And then a lot of people thought reduced bus ridership. So somebody who picked that, tell me what you thought.
Well, for the previous reasons why I would reduce the bus ridership, because you wouldn't wait an hour. You have to wait an hour for a bus in Boise. You would just ride share.
Right. And that's good. But here's something to think about. So I have a daughter who lives in Chicago. And one of the things I've noticed from her anecdotes is that Uber and Lyft have kind of built-in congestion pricing. So when the number of demanded rides starts to get close to the number of drivers, the price goes up. So my daughter in Chicago will a lot of times take Uber to dinner, but then take the bus back because Uber becomes too expensive. But would she take Uber if she couldn't take the bus back when Uber became too expensive? That
Yes, I picked reduced bus ridership, and initially thinking, well, yeah, but then it becomes cost prohibitive, and people are taking the buses, don't necessarily have sufficient funds to take an Uber or Lyft. So
exactly. So now the sharing function makes that Uber trip cheaper. When you get rid of the driver in Uber, it'll become cheaper. But you know, transit applying technology also has the potential to become cheaper. But what's happening in big urban areas, some of like San Francisco is seeing this trend of Uber causing more single occupant trips or just more auto trips, and it is eroding bus ridership. In some places, it's helping with last mile connectivity, but overall, it seems to be eroding bus ridership. And what's potentially scary about that is bus ridership, you cease to have the bus once your ridership gets to a certain level, and then you don't have the choice of the trip back on the bus. So these, again, things that we need to think about.
Well, why couldn't the bus be autonomous and a smaller size that enough people would be willing to pull together and still be a government entity?
Right.
That's kind of where I'm thinking autonomous is going, is it's all or nothing. This kind of half private sector is probably not going to be very successful, but if we all get on board, maybe.
that's a great point and a great vision. And I do think, I don't have that slide today, but one of the things I mentioned when I talk about sort of where transit is heading, that I think there's going to be this more varied spectrum of transit services. Mm-hmm. You know, right now you kind of have, you know, small human service door-to-door buses, you have medium-sized city buses, you have bigger city buses, which cost about the same because the cost is really the driver, and then they cost the same to operate, and then you have higher capacity modes like rail and commuter rail, and there could be more offerings along that spectrum when you get autonomous vehicles into the mix. So that's a great point, yeah. Well, good. So as we think about disruptors, we're beginning to see that there are some potential cause and effect relationships that could happen, and we start to see the benefits of exploring what that range of outcomes could be. So we're playing the what if game, but it has a purpose because we want to bring it back to what it means to our transportation system and the things that we need to plan for. So let's talk a little bit. This is at a high level. Our workshop tomorrow is going to do a deeper dive on how it is that we do exploratory planning. So let me preface that by saying the University of Maryland and the University of Oregon have done really thorough work on this, and there's also a TRB report. 750 was a series that they did that included an exploratory component. And they used land use models and transportation models, and it's very sophisticated. And a lot of what they were doing, both in Maryland and Oregon, was to play out these trends, look at the range of outcomes, and particularly look at their impact on the environment. So that was a big reason for them doing it, and doing it with their sophisticated models. The example that I'm referring to is in Virginia. We were doing this for our 2040 multimodal transportation plan, and we don't have a statewide transportation model, we don't have a statewide land use model. So we came up with a sketch planning approach that caused us to discover some ways of doing this at a little bit higher level and with some simplicity in it, but still allowing us to go through the steps of exploratory planning and have some insights. So the opportunities in exploratory planning range from the kind of sketch planning that I'm describing for the most part to a much more detailed exercise where you would actually use those models and have more specific outcomes, like, oh, look, this one has more congestion on 84, and this one has more congestion on the city streets of Boise or something like that. So so I just want to point out that there's a number of different ways that you can do exploratory planning. My example is a little bit on the higher level, higher plane of sketch planning. But ask me questions if you want to know, because I'm familiar with what others have done with it. So you start with the drivers, and that's what we've just been talking about for an hour, is the kinds of drivers that we need to think about. And what's important is asking yourself, what is the impact of that driver on transportation, and how uncertain is it? And the things that we want to focus on are the things that land up here in this quadrant. Because if it's not highly uncertain, then we can just do a regular forecast and we kind of know what's going to happen. And if it doesn't have a potentially big impact on transportation, then it's not necessarily what we need to focus on as a transportation planning agency. But so, you know, there's a range of drivers and then different transportation outcomes that you can consider. And we did in Virginia also look at some environmental drivers, but that's tricky. Usually the environmental factors that you look at are results of the planning, but there are some environmental factors that could affect transportation, and that's what you have to kind of have in your mind, the framework that we're asking. The drivers have to be things that affect transportation. So there's a lot of things about transportation that affect the environment, but how does the environment affect transportation, right? So Virginia, we have sea level rise, so that's an example of the environment affecting the transportation system. And in our scenario exercise, we also got into some assumptions about fuels, high heat days, and so we mixed in some economic things like fuels with things like high heat days and sea level rise. And then the other thing is, I do think if I were starting this today, I would factor in some different assumptions about how much of the vehicle fleet would become electric. And that might be considered an environmental factor, but it's also a little bit of an economic one too. So, So you start with the drivers, and then you assess them. And we did this in public meetings. It was kind of fun. People liked this dotting exercise, and we gave them that, those four quadrants, and we asked them, we gave them a little bit of information about some of the trends we identified, and this helped us pick the drivers that we were moving forward with. And then what you do in the process of exploratory planning is what we ended up calling developing a chain of logic. Because you're asking what could happen with this driver, and you need to understand, what are the trends that could happen here. So that's a lot of research, data analysis. You might extract some data from the models that you have now that describe, household trip behavior and things like that, and checking in with the experts. Then from the driver, you go to the assumptions about behavior. That's kind of what we were doing on that autonomous vehicle slide, right? We're thinking, well, if the vehicles are driving themselves, how does that affect people's behavior? So again, you go out and you look at research. Some people have already been doing modeling work on this, so we use their work to give us a range of assumptions that we might make about that. Again, expert input, and you can ask people too. What do you think you'll do differently? That's not the most reliable way of figuring this out by any means, but it is interesting. And I'll show you an example of that. After you sort of figure out from the driver's behavior, then you go to the impact. And again, this could be modeling, data analysis, and we end up having to do even more research here. But the point of the exercise is that you're starting from that driver, and then you're kind of creating this chain down to what is the impact of that driver based on the assumptions that you've made for that scenario. And you do have to define some different scenarios to do this so that you've got a variation in your assumptions about the drivers. But one of the things I want to mention is it's important to keep them a little bit soft for a while. Don't lock down your scenarios too soon, because as you do the research, you may find that it's not turning out the way you thought it would. And so you want to be able to adapt so that you can have your scenarios remain internally consistent, and that together the scenarios are going to give you that range of outcomes. So if two drivers that you put together start canceling each other out in your scenario, you might think, oh, let's move this assumption over to that scenario and this and that scenario's assumption over here, and I'm going to have a better mixture of outcomes. So it's important not to lock your scenarios down too soon in the process. And then there's a lot of different outcomes that you could look at. It depends on what tools you're using. So in Virginia, we kept the outcomes pretty general, and most of our results were in the, this is going up more than this is going down kind of thing. We have percentage increases, and then we did math in a spreadsheet to come up with our answers, but we present the results in a fairly qualitative way because we weren't doing true modeling. But if you were using a transportation demand model, like I said a moment ago, you could have some pretty specific results. So this is what I call this exploratory planning toolkit. You have a lot of data at your disposal, and you can use it to help apply the assumptions that you want to make about the drivers. So what you assume about your industry mix in the different scenarios can help you, and how those industries relate to the supply chain can help you ferret out that part of it. In tomorrow's session, we'll go into the nitty-gritty of some of this. The generation information is interesting. We made assumptions about what the millennials were doing differently in different scenarios, and then we used the information about the size of that group and their presence in the workforce out in 2040, and retirement assumptions about Generation X and things. So those were things that we varied in our scenarios. We had our core drivers, and then we also created, planners call this a transect. So it's a set of community types that describe everything. And this turned out to be really important. Anytime that you do scenario planning, it's really important to have a relationship between transportation and land use. So I'm gonna talk more about that in a moment. So we started with the drivers, we did some research, we understood the trends well enough to start dividing the trends the drivers and our assumptions about them into scenarios. And this is what we came up with in Virginia. So we had one called Industrial Renaissance. This was higher growth than the baseline projection, so more population and job growth, but more of an industrial outcome, less of an urban outcome. So in this one, we assume the millennials moved to the suburbs like their parents did, for example. And then we had Techtopia. So this is high-tech in an economic sense, but also more urban and more multimodal. We maxed out telecommuting in this one, for example. Then we had a moderate growth, similar to the baseline forecast, but our stakeholder group really wanted to play with what would happen with, you know, more of the population being the retired, retirement age folks, but putting them in those walkable places. So this is kind of our more of a small town attraction scenario. And then finally, we had reduced growth. Virginia's very sensitive to the federal spending levels. We have a lot of the military and other functions in Virginia, so we modeled reduced federal spending, and then slower adoption of technology was something we played out here. So we called that one general slowdown, and which is a little bit of a play on words if you think about it. So they were, and it's very important in doing this kind of exercise that the scenarios are different enough that you're going to get a range of outcomes and be able to have some insights. If they're too close to each other, you can end up not really getting the full value out of the exercise. And again, we're not trying to say, well, I want this one. We're trying to learn from them individually and collectively as we see how the different assumptions about these trends play out. So let me circle back to what I said about community types and having a connection between land use and transportation. So I mentioned we didn't have statewide models to work with, but we wanted to be able to have our outcomes relate to Virginia. And so what we did was we divided the state up into the types of communities that exist today, but we defined them in a way, we had done a statewide transit accessibility measurement for our statewide long-range plan, our needs assessment, and what that means is how many jobs people can get to by transit. In this case, that's how we defined it. And then activity density is people and plus jobs per acre. So those were the variables that we used to define our place types. And the purpose was so that we could have areas that had noticeable differences in travel behavior as it relates to land use patterns. So multimodal, urban. By the way, there's a V7 that exists, but not in Virginia. That's like a true big city. We just don't have that. V6 we had, which is multimodal urban, and then high density suburban, which is still multimodal, but more so than this one, V4. So these were kind of distinctly different place types that we had. We have small towns, we have low density suburban, and we have rural. And Virginia is a very rural state, so the light green is rural. And I've been there almost 20 years, and I didn't realize we didn't have a big city in Virginia. That was a revelation to me, believe it or not. Because we think of ourselves as having a big city because it's right there on the other side of the Potomac River. But it's not in Virginia, and we don't have it. And Arlington, which is just outside D.C., and Norfolk, and downtown Richmond get close to true urban, like, big city densities, but not quite. So it's interesting. When you see it mapped out, you think, my gosh, it's really mostly rural. But we do, as you zoom into these areas, you see we have a complexity of types. And what we wanted to be able to differentiate was places that had a really different mode split, where people are able to bike more, or where people are able to use transit, versus places that they're not. But, you know, we get out in the rural areas, and the carpool mode is actually pretty high. So,
I have a question. Over here.
Yeah.
So in this analysis, you're looking at how the land use drives transportation needs, not how transportation infrastructure drives land use, right?
Well, they're interrelated.
Yeah.
They're interrelated. So we just want to be able to, in the end, we want to be able to have a different outcome in these different areas because land use allows a different mode split and different trip generation rates, if you will. So households in a city generate fewer miles of travel every day than a household out in the country. So, you know, by using that information that we have about existing communities, it gave us something that we could vary in our future scenarios. And so we could put, you know, more of the future growth in a particular place type, and then we'd have a different outcome in terms of the transportation. So that was the reason we did that in the first place, but then we realized that we were going to be able to change our technology assumptions on the basis of the community types, and that turned out to be extremely useful as well. So I admit that was an accident, but or not an accident, but we seized the opportunity when we realized it. But when we originally set up the community types, it was more for that first reason that I stated, that we just wanted to be able to have different outcomes in our scenario, our exploratory process. So, but from a theoretical standpoint, it's important because, as I said, linking land use to transportation is something that you always want to do in a planning exercise like this, because it is true that transportation affects urban form and urban form affects transportation. So, let me ask you if you how much you agree with everything that I just said so emphatically. but from the perspective of technology, will technology affect travel differently in different community types? So think about that. You can think about Uber and Lyft. Are they different in an urban environment than a suburban or a rural environment? Or people's likelihood of using autonomous vehicles? So most of you strongly agree, not literally a majority of those, so agree or strongly agree. So can you think of any examples of that? How would Uber and Lyft operate differently in a more rural environment? Or maybe have a different transportation impact? Do you think people, go ahead.
I think there's going to be less demand in a rural area, and there's going to be less supply. So it's going to be more expensive to take an Uber, let's say, from Cunin to downtown Boise than, say, from the North End to downtown Boise. So you're going to have the probably cheaper for that person that's 15 miles out to drive in versus taking an Uber for that trip.
Right. Thank you. That's exactly what I was trying to see if you agree with that point. So that's a great example that some of the ways that technology would play out could be different in communities. And we did an exercise at the beginning of our scenario analysis where we asked people, where do you think you will live in 20 years? And we gave them the community types. And then we asked them, how do you think you'll get around? And we gave them choices between driving, owning a car you drive yourself, owning a car that drives itself, sharing a ride such as Uber and Lyft, but with a driver in it, or and then we have a transit version of that, and then finally having an autonomous riding in somebody else's autonomous vehicle. And we saw this correlation where the people who said they wanted to live in the more urban places were much more embracing of those more autonomous modes of travel, and particularly the shared use modes of travel, transit and autonomous Uber. And as you went to the more rural places, just as you said, it seems like it won't be as economical. So people are thinking, well, I'm still going to have to own my own car. It's going to be expensive for somebody to come get me. So that really played out in the research that we did, both the public input and as we looked at it from an economic standpoint. And some people are working on this question right now, and with every passing week, there's more research being done that will help an exploratory scenario process have some good reference materials for these kinds of assumptions. So this is another way that having that connection between land use and transportation is helpful. So then again, we started to look at how this could vary by place type as well. So this kind of factor is more likely to happen in the urban areas. This might be more likely to happen in suburban areas, but probably not rural necessarily, or exurban, let's say. So we took a look at these assumptions, and we also varied them by place type and according to the framework of each scenario. So that gave us the building blocks to have different outcomes in our different scenarios. And that's, again, the essence of exploratory planning, is that you're trying to sort of link these assumptions and ideas about the future transportation system together in a way that's going to produce that range of outcomes for you. Similarly, we looked at the efficiency side. So we talked about this earlier, that you can get more, so VMT is expected to go up, but you can also get more efficiency out of your system and more throughput, which effectively increases road capacity as a result of these same trends: information, automation, connectedness. So we also vary that according to the roadway network, so not the place type, but we looked at different types of facilities, and there is already some research out there about how much more capacity we could get out of highways versus like signalized arterials versus other types of roads. So we did some GIS analysis to help us play out this part of the scenario analysis. But honestly, one of the things that is critical to ask yourself is about timing. So, but I'll just plant that seed and we'll come back to that. So, and I didn't have the slide in here, but I did. So on the transit front, the other thing that we realized was that we have a more robust spectrum of services. And that was something that we started to play out in our visualizations for the future. So again, using those building blocks in our scenario analysis, we just kind of went through this exercise of connecting our assumptions about the drivers with research that helped us understand how that would affect behavior, and that led us to the impacts on the transportation system. And so that brings us to some of our outcomes. So I'm just going to give you just a few high-level findings from what we did. But before I start this, let me just ask any other questions or thoughts about sort of that was a very high-level glimpse of how sort of the process for exploratory planning. Does it kind of make sense to you?
Yeah. On the land use side, did you look at how the different scenarios might affect kind of the community design? With the idea that if fewer people will own their own vehicles, taking advantage of different technologies, could we then maybe start building communities differently when we don't have to accommodate all the cars?
So that's an excellent question. And we incorporated that in our visualizations that I'll show you in a minute to help people acknowledge that and start thinking about that. But we didn't have a need to literally model that. If you were doing a full-blown modeling exercise with land use and transportation models, you would want to think about that, how you're using land differently in urban and suburban areas because of the reduction in parking. And I'll tell you something I heard at this Urbanism Next conference that I think is going to become prevalent is people are already thinking ahead. What does it mean that we might not need as much parking? That seems like a pretty robust finding of everyone's research. And they're speaking to the development industry and saying, stop building ramped parking decks right now. Build flat decks with sufficient height and ramps on the ends so that it can be converted to another type of use without knocking it down in the future. So that's an example of something we can look ahead to where this is headed as we think through these trends and say, the life cycle of parking decks is pretty long, so this is something we need to think about right now. So that's a good example.
Seems like there'd be opportunities for densification of land use too, because just as I was driving to this meeting, by all these sort of low density auto-oriented commercial areas, and it just seems like that's going to go away in the future, and there will be more housing or more compact commercial development or something. So there's some opportunities there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That very well potentially could be the case. And I think, as happens with any trend, there's this, as you were saying earlier, the transportation affects land use patterns just as the land use patterns affect people's travel behavior. And this is as significant as the change from horse and buggy to automobile. And I don't think, people were still building manure barns when vehicles were becoming the dominant mode of transportation. So, we're at that moment in time where we need to change our thinking, and it's hard to do. But if we could learn something from the last century, it's that we need to think.